I'm excited to talk to you about our latest work that has been happening in my group at Stanford around modeling super fine grained of the spread of COVID-19 and providing a decision support tool for policymakers in making decisions. So, you know, let's go a year back when the COVID pandemic started, coronavirus outbreak hit us all back in March 2020. And there were some drastic measures that were being made and implemented by most of the countries around the world, like lockdowns, stay at home, closing entire countries, things like that. And of course, at the same time, a lot was unknown. So a lot of different country leaders and a lot of different news and was there around different types of strategies we may want to make to cope with the pandemic. And here I'm showing some of the titles of news articles from that time. And of course, all this uncertainty, all these big hard measures that people have taken, that countries were forced to take, also created quite a bit of backlash in terms of do we have to do this? Does it help? Do we have to stay at home because it's hard on everyone? And this is really when our group came in and said, you know, can we stop many of our current research projects and let's focus on helping fight the pandemic. So we ask ourselves, you know, how could we help? How could machine learning, data mining, data science help in this area and provide some insights that would help us move forward? And one thing that is very important when you think about, let's say, modeling the pandemic and predicting how things will spread is that the world is amazingly non-stationary. Right, people's behaviors are changing daily based on the news, based on the measures taken, and it is very hard to make any kind of accurate predictions because the underlying situations, the underlying behaviors, of the people, the underlying contact patterns are changing from an hour to hour in very kind of unpredictable ways. So. What is important to understand here is that it's very hard to make predictions because the world under the pandemic is like changing super drastically. So when our work comes in is we were saying, okay, let's make a step back and let's think from the first principles and see if we can make a contribution here. So the way our thinking went back in March 2020 was the following, was to say, look, viruses, right, including coronavirus, spreads through human contact. Right. And there is this underlying contact network that modulates the spread of the virus. Right. And somebody's position in the network will have and the number of connections they have will have a huge effect on how the virus is spreading. Right. So a simple model can be that whenever you come into a contact with somebody who's not infected yet, who's susceptible, the virus may jump from an infected or an infectious to a susceptible person with a small probability beta. And of course, depending on the structure of this network, the spread of the virus will be very different. And one of the main problems in epidemiology is that we don't know the structure of this underlying contact network, right? So we don't know whether the network of contacts between humans is like the one here on the left, or is it like the right, the one here on the right? And of course, the consequences for the spread of the virus are huge, depending on whether it's the left network or the right network. And because of this, because the network is unknown, most epidemiological models then assume a fully connected graph, right? Basically, a full mixing in the population, which basically means that anyone can infect anyone else. And especially if you want to model large populations, right? Maybe if you want to model a single small village, maybe this is a not so bad assumption because everyone knows everyone. But if you want to model massive populations, I know entire US or entire population of Europe, then clearly this is not a good assumption to make. So our premise when we came into this work was if we can estimate very accurately and at a very fine-grained level this dynamic human contact network, then we'll be able to do accurate virus modeling and even more, we'll be able to run a lot of what-if type analysis that will open the box and will allow us kind of to understand the properties and the spreading of the virus. And most importantly, it will give us some ideas and strategies how should we reopen the economy. So the question we started with was, how could we accurately estimate this dynamic contact network for, you know, let's say 100 million people, right? We want to model a super large population and really determine how people are connected with each other and how these connections are changing over time. So our work starts with using large amounts of cell phone location data. So basically, based on how cell phones move through the world, we are going to infer an hourly contact network of for 10 largest US metropolitan areas, which means 100 million people. For every hour of the day, there will be a new network for, you know, for days, for weeks, for months. And the data we are using comes from a company called SafeGraph that provides anonymized aggregated location data coming from many cell phone applications. And data is freely accessible at the following URL for research related to COVID. And it basically gives us some idea about how many people are staying at home and what kind of locations these people are visiting, as well as we have information about the types of the visit, in a sense, how long do visits tend to last, and what is the square footage area of the place that people tend to visit. And based on this, we have decided to basically build a mobility model that considers two types of locations. It considers neighborhoods here at the bottom in green circles. These are census areas of around 600 people. So for every block of 600 people, we have a separate node, and we'll call that a neighborhood. And then we have places which are called points of interest, and this would be individual pharmacies, markets, restaurants, grocery stores, gas stations, basically every place that you can visit and has a name would be a node in this graph. And then for every hour of the day, for every hour of every day, we are going to estimate how many people from a given neighborhood visited a given point of interest. And we have built this statistical inference engine that allows us to take in raw mobility data, allows us to take in census data, and infer this hourly mobility network for 10 largest metropolitan areas in US. As I said, around 100 million people total. We have over 500,000 different points of interest. So as I said, grocery stores, churches, schools, all kinds of locations, and about 60,000 different neighborhoods, with the number of people living in each neighborhood between, I think it's like 600 to about 2,000. And now that we have built this very accurate and very fine-grained mobility network, I want to show you how the mobility patterns look like. So here is the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. At the bottom, you see neighborhoods. On the top, you see individual points of interest. And lines represent that somebody from that neighborhood visited a given point of interest. And you see, for example, most of these lines are vertical, which means people go to the places in their neighborhoods, but some of them are kind of diagonal, and that means that somebody kind of commuted to that point of interest. And this is Monday, 1 p.m. on March 2nd, and this is Monday, 1 p.m. on April 6th. And you see how drastically the mobility changed between these two, let's say, Mondays at 1 p.m. So clearly, there is a lot going on in the world over time. And this data kind of captures that and reveals that. On top of that, we then decided to build a simple rudimentary epidemiological model. It's an SEIR model for that basically models how people move from susceptible to exposed to infectious to recovered. And our model will only have three fixed scalar parameters that don't change over time. One is the transmission probability at the point of interest, so how likely an infectious person is to infect a susceptible person if they come in contact at the point of interest. Then another property, another beta CBG, is the transmission constant at the level of neighborhood, and all neighborhoods have the same value. And then the other parameter is P0, which is the initial fraction of infected population. Again, just one simple scalar. And the way our model will work is the idea is given here. Basically, we will randomly infect P0 number of people or particles at neighborhoods. And then according to the mobility network, particles are going to travel to points of interest. At the points of interest, kind of particles are going to mix with each other. So infectious people and the susceptible visitors are going to mix. And the infections are going to jump between them with this beta POI. And we are also going to account the visit duration, so dwell time, and we are also going to account the physical area of that space. And you know, this is what happens in 1 hour, and then these particles go back home, and again at home they can infect each other, they mix with this beta CVG probability. And this is basically the system we've been building for about 2-3 months, because it required a lot of engineering, a lot of data, and a lot of method development to be able to infer this network and then superimpose the epidemiological model. And we were quite unsure whether all this is going to work kind of at the height of the pandemic and at the height of the lockdowns. We were quite nervous. So here is a small simulation about how this looks like. This is now Chicago metropolitan area. So here's the Chicago area. Here's the downtown. This is the lake. Here is the mobility pattern. Over time, this is March. So right now we are on March 19, and you see how mobility dropped from around 2 million visits to points of interest, and it's dropping. And here you see how the number of inhabitants in different states is changing over time, with susceptible being up here on top. And notice the scale is logarithmic. And basically, our model looks at these mobility patterns, and based on the mobility patterns, it's predicting in what neighborhoods people will get infected. And you see how now the neighborhoods are getting redder and redder because more and more people are getting infected. But you see how they are not getting red uniformly, but they are different based on the behavior of the people in those neighborhoods. So with all this being built, of course, the question is, does this fit? Is it able to model the virus, how it is spreading? And what kind of interesting modeling results are we able to obtain from it? So what I'm going to show you next is to talk about four different analyses we've been able to make with this model. It's about the impact of social distancing, about super spreader locations, riskiest POIs, as well as some strategies for reopening the economy and discovering social disparities. So first, the question is, does the model fit well? And what I show here is for nine different metropolitan areas. Gray axis are the daily reported case counts, and you see how huge variability there is. Blue is our model's prediction of daily case counts, and the orange is just a smooth line of reported cases as a guide to the eye. And what you see is that, you know, in some cases we fit better, in some we fit worse, but importantly, we are able to fit all these different trajectories, like the New York City that had a huge outbreak, for example, San Francisco, who had a kind of an outbreak and then kind of a steady number of cases, same as Philadelphia, or perhaps like Washington, D.C. or Dallas, that, you know, were on the rise. And again, the same model is able to capture these very different case trajectories. So the first question we asked, you know, or society, population, really changed their behavior patterns, right? This is data that shows number of visits over time to different types of places. And you see how, for example, around March 20th, the visits to a large number of different places significantly dropped. And the question is, did people staying at home, did this really help spread, help stop the spread of COVID? And what our simulations show is that the magnitude of mobility reduction is really, really important. And if the population would keep behaving as it was, so, you know, if we would just keep behaving as we did in the early March, in a single month, 32% of the entire population would be infected with the virus. And this is our simulation. Here is time. Black is the reality. So what is the true number of cases? And yellow is what would happen if our mobility would remain unchanged. And then these are other simulations. If mobility drop would be half of the actual mobility drop, or 25% of the mobility of the actual mobility drop, right? So kind of conclusion is that stay at home policies and measures and people kind of staying at home, reducing the number of connections in the contact network drastically helped in helping us stop the spread of the virus. What our model allows us to do, it allows us to predict both who gets infected and where they get infected. And what we find out is that actually there is a very small number of these points of interest where most large majority of infections are predicted to happen. So about 10% of the points of interest account for 85% of infections. And you know, here is a set of categories of different of points of interest based on their kind of risk, which would be the way we compute here is to say, if you were to fully reopen this type of points of interest, how many new infections can you expect? And right, it's basically places where people congregate close together to each other for long periods of time, like full service restaurants, fitness centers, coffee bars, and so on. Right, and then you know, like things that are more outside, more open, are predicted to cause much less new infections. And then the third analysis I wanna show is that our model also allows us to think about how do we reopen the economy, and in particular, our model allows us to reason about not just that reopening the economy is an all or nothing type situation, but that you can fractionally reopen the economy. And the what this graph is trying to show is the following, is that there are these very nice kind of nonlinear effects that happen in the data. So for example, this is what I show on this graph is, what is the fraction of visits lost from partial reopening versus how many infections are predicted to happen? And of course, the idea is if I fully reopen, then I'll get a lot of infections and I won't lose any foot traffic. I won't lose any business if I'm store owner. And of course, if I close the economy, then I will lose a lot of business, but I won't create too many new infections. These percentages points here show what happens if we reopen the economy at a certain fraction of maximum occupancy, right? So every restaurant, every store has maximum occupancy that says what is the safe number of people that can be there at a given point in time. And now the idea is, what if we, for example, reopen the economy to say at any point in time there can be at most 20% of maximum occupancy people there? And for example, if you do that, what we notice is that we only lose about 40% of the foot traffic, right? So only 40% of the business gets lost, even though you open at 20% capacity. So you don't lose 80% of the business, you only lose 40. And then, you know, if you say how many infections do we save by doing that, you are reducing the number of infections by more than 80%, right? From 40,000 down to less than 50. Right. So this allows you basically to now reason about what would happen if I reopen different parts of economy at different occupancy levels and understand the trade-offs between the amount of business lost versus the stress on the population and the healthcare system. So it allows you to kind of evaluate this important trade-off. And the last thing that our model allows us to do is also understand what neighborhoods people that are infected come from. And what has been observed in the United States, and I think across the world as well, is that poor neighborhoods are at much higher risk for COVID infections. That basically people with low socioeconomic status, they have higher risk, neighborhoods get much more hit by COVID. And it is unclear why is that happening. And, you know, our model doesn't know what neighborhoods are rich and what neighborhoods are poor. Our model has the same background probability of infection for all neighborhoods. And it has the same kind of probability of infection for all points of interest. The only difference between points of interest is how long people stay there and how what is the square foot area of the points of interest. And the only difference between neighborhoods in our model is the travel patterns that people have. So what we asked ourselves was, does our model, without really knowing what neighborhoods are rich and poor, does it capture this disparity between infections in high, let's say, rich and poor neighborhoods. And what we find out is that our model actually captures this pattern without us ever, fitting the model to it. So what I show here is the relative infection risk between low and high income census block groups. And you see that the risk is quite asymmetric, and that low income neighborhoods in our model are about, 1.5 to twice as likely to get the risk is between 1.5 and 2 times bigger than in high income neighborhoods. And of course, the question is, why is that? Like, how can our model capture this if the underlying epidemiological model is the same for all neighborhoods? And what is interesting is, first, we observed that low income neighborhoods saw a much smaller decline in terms of mobility. So what I show here, just as examples, over time, y-axis is mobility for low income in pink, and high income in yellow. And you see how low income neighborhoods were able to reduce their mobility much less than high income neighborhoods. We don't know why that is. So it could be because of high income jobs, you are able to work from home. Low income jobs, you actually have to drive to work. It could be in terms of education, trust in science, a lot of different reasons why high income was able to reduce mobility, but low income did not. So this is what, but this is only one part of the explanation. Another part of explanation that is interesting is that we find out that points of interest visited by low-income CBGs also have higher transmission rates. And for example, a single trip to a grocery store is twice as dangerous for a low-income individual than for a high-income individual. And the question is, why would a single trip to the grocery store pose so different risk? And what we find out is that people from low-income CBGs would go to grocery stores that have 60% more hourly visitors per square foot or per square meter, and that people tend to stay in these grocery stores 17% longer overall. So basically, it is both the travel patterns as well as the selection of places in which people from low-income neighborhoods go that have higher densities and of people and stay there longer that contribute to this much higher risk. So these are some of the examples that our model allows us to gain and that help policymakers making decisions. So we have published this paper. So we started the project in March. By mid-June, here you see we submitted the paper. We were then going through rounds of revisions, got accepted in October, and published this on November 10th. And this was really work by three PhD students at Stanford Computer Science, Serena, Emma, and Pang Wei. And what was really interesting is that after this work published, kind of its impact and attention to it really exploded, right? So there was over 400 news articles and news outlets that reported about our research and about the consequences of it, because this was the first work that actually revealed how restaurants, gyms, and cafes, can be kind of hotspots and what factors are important in the spread of the virus. What is perhaps even more important is that we are working very closely with various policy decision-making public health officials, where we give them these tools for reopening the economy, where basically they can play with these sliders and say, what happens if we reopen the economy according to these types of thresholds? What can we expect in terms of number of case counts? And not only for, let's say, here, the entire state of Virginia, but also for different subparts, for different counties, for different areas in Virginia. So we are working with Virginia Department of Health, as well as several counties in United States, cities, and other organizations in making this tool available for more accurate decision making, because we are able to do this in real time, right? Like the data that public health officials get is usually a few weeks old, and even if they get test cases, you only basically are able to measure to detect an infection about 10 days after the actual infection happened, while our model allows you to see infections kind of as they happen in real time. And I would say that this research really had impact on millions of people, right? Like many governments over across the world used literally the plots from our paper as a justification for their measures. U.S. states, governors are referring to our work again as a way to make decisions. And even U.S. Supreme Court is citing our paper in deciding kind of deciding certain cases. So really, you know, I would say we who work on, you know, recommender systems big data and social networks are used to impacting hundreds of millions of people. But this is a very different type of work that also had this type of impact. So to conclude, right, what are we working on right now? I gave you the overview of the modeling, the first wave of the pandemic, so kind of March to June 2020. Now we have expanded our framework that allows us to take raw mobility data, as well as importantly include daily mask use to build even more accurate models. And for example, what has changed in the subsequent waves? You know, this is the first wave, March to May 2020. This is, for example, the second wave, November 20, January 21. These are different types of models. What we need to do is we still need a lot. We need mobility data. It is very important. We need mask wearing data. If we don't have mask wearing, then our model kind of tends, mobility-based model tends to overpredict. So it's important to model mask wearing. And another thing that turned out to be important is to allow this background probability of infection in a neighborhood to be increasing over time. So we allow it to linearly increase over time, and that further decreases the error. So basically now we further improved the model to be able to model subsequent waves of the pandemic as well. You know, what are some conclusions? Fine-grained mobility networks are essential for modeling pandemics, and even simple models lead to accurate case-fit trajectories over, you know, massive amounts of people or large-scale populations. The model is very scalable. We can model 500,000 locations, 100 million people, and really allows for these microscopic trends down to individual neighborhoods and individual locations, because we are predicting and modeling at the individual human being in some sense. And right, these type of models, this allow for fine-grained analysis that can inform both more effective as well as more equitable responses to the pandemic. With this, I'm done. You know, thank you to my group, all the collaborators, partners, and also acknowledging the funding. Thank you so much, and happy to take questions.